So Michael Burry is not only betting that long-term US treasuries are going to tank, but he's also betting that Cathie Wood's innovation fund will perform really badly for the rest of this year. Tesla's AI Day unveiled a humanoid robot that is literally identical to my body size, and most importantly, unthreatening. But what I'm really excited about beyond the software architecture of tackling autonomous driving is the Dojo computer's cost and revenue implications. I think some of us are not aware how much it actually costs to train neural networks, not to mention the level of compute necessary to train Tesla's neural networks. For Tesla, it's just a little bit shy of 10,000 GPUs that's necessary. And can you imagine the power consumption by these 10,000 GPUs that will literally run 24/7? And lastly, BHP have offloaded their energy business to Woodside, and they've decided to delist from London. All of that have pulled their share price down by almost 20%. So I want to talk about whether BHP is attractive at the current price as well. Clearly, this is going to be a longer episode. And if you enjoy longer episodes like these, just let me know in the comment section below or gently smash a like button. As usual, if you really enjoy what I'm doing, consider supporting the channel via Patreon. And no, this video is not financial advice or recommendation to do anything. So without further ado, let's go. So the first thing I want to talk about is Dr. Burry shorting, essentially betting against Cathie Wood's ARKK Innovation Fund to perform poorly for the rest of the year. I think this news headline is a little bit hyped just because riders love to jump on the bandwagon whenever Dr. Burry is involved or Cathie Wood's involved because it draws a lot of eyeballs. Now, to put things in perspective, Scion Asset Management, that's run by Dr. Burry, have a relatively small amount of put contracts compared to the other funds. Now, you can see the other funds have a lot more asset under management except for LH Capital, it's actually pretty small. They have a lot more put contracts on Cathie's ARKK Innovation ETF. Now, the easiest way to understand what's inside Dr. Burry's fund is to go to Whale Wisdom, type in Scion Asset Management, and then you can see the latest 13F filing. Now, it's really important to understand that the 13F filing only reflects up to Q2 2021. So it's usually behind. And therefore, a lot of his positions might not be accurate anymore. He might have added more into his Tesla puts, which he actually did as of 30th of June 2021. He added 34% more. So he is essentially betting that Tesla is going to be worth less moving forward. And he also bet more that US long-term treasuries are going to be worth less as well. So if US treasuries are going to go down in prices, then therefore the yields are going to go up, essentially destroying some of the valuation of the high growth stocks. So that's something to pay attention to. Also, when we get to Dr. Burry's put position on ARKK, it's really important to note that firstly, this position is really small. It's only about 1.5% of the fund, right? It's not really a big deal compared to the other funds. At the same time, he's also buying put contracts on ARKK. He's not actually shorting the stock, if you will. But yes, with put contracts, you're still betting that ARKK will perform pretty poorly over time. The important thing to note when it comes to shorting is that your timing has to be pretty good, because when you're going long, you can eventually just wait until your thesis pan out. With shorting, if it doesn't go down, then you're gonna lose money, right? I'll type a proper answer of the difference between put contracts and shorting in the comment section below for those of you who are interested, but I'm not gonna talk too much about that. And more importantly, I think it's really worthwhile pointing out that the investing style between Dr. Burry and also Cathie Wood are like completely different. Cathie Wood is very much focused on early stage, hyper growth type companies, whereas Dr. Burry is focusing on more mature companies, and his investing style is more like Warren Buffett or Charlie Munger. What I'm trying to say is that Dr. Burry is just not like Cathie Wood in terms of how he invests. So his expression of put contracts on ARKK is essentially just saying that the valuation for some of the companies in ARKK is a bit too much. It's probably going to come back down. And I have built a watch list of all of Burry's long positions, except for Tesla. Tesla is more of a put contract. And you can see that like their PE ratio are so different. Now, you can see that companies like Google, Facebook, their EV EBITDA is pretty reasonable at 22 times, 18 times, PE ratios at around 26, 29 times. And if you look at CVS, it's around 15 times and EV EBITDA's at 9 times. And when you compare Dr. Burry's long positions with Cathie Wood's positions, they're like completely different. Tesla is at a 100 times EV EBITDA, 300 times PE. So it's just describing companies at different stages of their life cycle.
Okay, cool story, bro. How does that impact people like us?
Now, the thing about short sellers is that for companies that's actually in stretch valuation territory, the short sellers will pull those valuation back down into more reasonable prices. And I think that's good for people like us who do want to ultimately enter into the market at more reasonable prices. So I see that more as an opportunity to own high quality names that I never had a chance to buy because they're too expensive, if you will. With Tesla's AI Day, it's important to acknowledge that this is meant to be a recruitment event for top tier AI talent. So they didn't dumb down any of the technical details at all, which means that for people like me, I have to essentially pause the video too many times to Google what exactly was happening. So for this section of the video, we're gonna keep this hopefully as simple as possible. What was really interesting to me beyond the software architecture and beyond the Tesla bot is the hardware, the D1 chip, and collectively the Dojo computer. We know from Tesla Autonomy Day that they already have a full self-driving chip that they developed in all of the Tesla cars being sold currently. But the bottleneck to full self-driving is the level of compute necessary to train the Tesla Autopilot program. In the presentation, they mentioned that to train the Tesla Autopilot program, it costs approximately 10,000 GPUs and probably some more. But the 10,000 GPUs is just a part of the cost. Because imagine that the hardware costs money, you also need people to look after the hardware, and imagine the power consumption of that hardware as well. When they unveiled the D1 chip and collectively the Dojo computer, if they can actually deliver what was promised on those specs, the cost savings and the efficiency that the Dojo computer can provide, I think is going to be a massive moat, stretching the distance between the current autopilot providers, and I'm talking about GM's Cruise, Google's Waymo, and Intel's Mobileye. That distance is going to be so far apart, it's just... Yeah, it's going to be crazy. On top of that, these supercomputers are dedicated to work on neural network problems. So if this does work out in Tesla's favor, eventually they can actually open that up for other people to use their supercomputers as neural network training as a service. So this will directly compete with Google's TPUs, which is Tensor Processing Units, and also AWS. With TeslaBot, aka Optimus Subprime, is essentially a step to help everyone understand that stop comparing Tesla with the legacy automakers because they're just on a class of its own. And it shows how ambitious and how visionary the company actually is. Now, of course, I'm biased because I'm a Tesla shareholder, but sure, you can make your own observations and conclusions. But I think the TeslaBot have two broader implications. On the business side, it will generate a lot of value that's unmeasurable at this point, and you can classify that as the blue ocean strategy if you have read that book. And it's probably really hard to even try and size the market for robotics. But it's more likely going to do the repetitive tasks that humans don't want to do or put humans in danger. That makes sense for Tesla bots, especially in last mile delivery. But there's going to be wider socioeconomic consequences of having Tesla bot, because those tasks still generate income for a portion of the population. And when you wipe that out, it's going to hurt a portion of the population way more than others. So this might actually spark a bigger conversation around education and training. Like, how do we provide the right training and education for the next generation so that we can update our own skill set to match where the world is heading towards? So what's interesting about BHP is that they went from $53 to $44 in a span of about a week. This is a 16% type correction, pretty steep. And there's been a couple announcements that's really worthwhile talking about independently. Major announcement is that BHP have decided to sell their oil and gas business to Woodside. And I think this is just them saying that they want to focus on renewable energy. And I actually think that this is a great move to offload some of these fossil fuel assets while they still have value. Now, depending on who you talk to, they might not agree with that. And in the near term, their ability to generate cash flow is going to be impacted, and therefore the dividends are going to be impacted. So if you talk to a dividend-focused investors, they're not going to be happy about this. But for me, I'm a little bit biased. I like the fact that they're focusing on renewable energy, and moving forward, that revenue stream will be a lot more sustainable compared to something like Woodside, where you're selling oil. But in reality, I don't think BHP selling off their energy business to Woodside is really impacting their share price all that much. I think that BHP announcing their delisting from London Stock Exchange have a bigger impact to the share price decline. So BHP announced that there is intention for them to leave the London Stock Exchange and just focus on their listing on the Australian Stock Exchange. Now, they listed in the London Stock Exchange as part of a merger with the South African mining company Billiton back in 2001. And because of that, they're actually a big part of the top 100 company in London. If they were to delist from London Stock Exchange, then it basically triggers the automatic removal of BHP from the index. And if you remove BHP from the index, then it means that a lot of the passive investing strategy will have to sell off BHP as part of not being part of the index anymore. So that would hurt the valuation substantially. On top of that, I think what have also hurt BHP's share price is that if oil and gas is no longer part of BHP's core business, then they're really depending on mining. And with mining, it's really sensitive to commodity prices, and iron ore prices falling, it's just not going to help BHP's valuation. On top of that, BHP also lost a lot of value from their thermal coal mine that they were planning to sell. And this should wake people up in terms of how much the coal mines are actually worth in today's prices. Now, the coal mine, which is like the largest coal mine in New South Wales, was worth $2 billion a few years ago. And that was cut by more than $1 billion in January. So for any of the retail investors thinking of deep value plays like coal mines, I would seriously think again. And if you want to read more literature and also more independent research on this, there are two energy reports basically from RethinkX, which really talks about the true valuation of fossil fuel type assets. And this is why I'm actually really liking BHP taking action right now and selling off those fossil fuel assets while they still have value. Because in a couple of years' time, those valuations could be slashed even more. And to answer the question whether I like the company at the current prices at $44. And I did a very simple model to try and understand whether there is an opportunity with BHP. And I assume that after 5 years, they're gonna grow their business by approximately 3%, which is, I think, country GDP. And EV EBITDA, I gave them a 9x. And I assume that some of their operating cash flows is probably not really going to move all that much. They might have a couple bad years in the near term to try and adjust to renewable energy, and then they're gonna have a couple good years to essentially grow faster, and that will probably balance each other out. So gave them a pretty relatively conservative assumption, I would say, and the expected return is around 50% after 5 years, which is not that good. But again, remember that I gave them really conservative assumptions. If you guys have different opinion, let me know in the comment section below. So this is a good time to do a portfolio update. As I'm recording this video, my CMC market portfolio side of things is worth 107,000 Australian dollars. And it did go backwards mostly because of Asia. Everything else is mostly the same. And I'm sorry that in previous episodes, I forgot to scroll down and actually show the rest of my portfolio. In the short-term portfolio side of things, I've talked about this in the past, NRW Holdings and Redbubble are part of my portfolio. I probably own them for a little bit less than a year. Not going to hold them for all that long. I don't particularly like Redbubble's business model, to be perfectly honest, but it's been doing pretty well, and I will let you guys know what I decide to do with it in a little bit. With Micron Tech, I think that it's doing what it's supposed to do, and the valuation is really attractive. It's semiconductors. It's not something that you solve in a short amount of time. There's continue gonna be supply chain problems, and people saying that there is not enough demand for memory chips is like the exact opposite of what the CFO said. So yeah, not concerned whatsoever. Now, the two positions that I did add over the week is actually CrowdStrike and Peloton. I'm not going to go into extensive reasoning for why I did that. I did explain in my Discord server, and I made a dedicated video on that. But if you want me to do a proper video to explain why I like CrowdStrike and Peloton, just let me know in the comment section below. Now, with my stake account, it's currently worth $45,000, and that's give or take approximately 60,000 Australian dollars. And not too many changes on this side, other than I have swapped out Ozone for Snowflake. Now, Snowflake is a really interesting business to me. And this is a business that I talked about early in the year in my Patreon and my Discord server that I mentioned I would like to own this at one day, but the valuation was so stretched at the time I was not interested. But for a brief moment in Snowflake, the share price actually went down to, I believe, not at 266, it actually went down to around 258. Yeah, 248 at one point. And that became really, really attractive. There were a couple of pieces of bad news for Snowflake, and that's why it triggered a sell-off, but that didn't last very long. It only lasts like a couple of minutes before institutional investors basically picked that up like really quickly. I, for some reason, was awake at 2 a.m. and I saw the opportunity and I decided to take the opportunity. Now, besides that, everything else is mostly the same. I'm pretty happy with everything that I have, and some have definitely outperformed compared to others, like, for example, Regeneron and Amazon actually went backwards. I'm not concerned. I'm not about to sell that either. And Bristol Myers, I'm happy with everything else that I have. So I'm not sponsored by Stake, but if you do want to try Stake for yourself and wouldn't mind a free stock, I left the link in the description box below. So thank you so much for hanging out with me all the way to the end. If you did learn something new, consider gently smacking the like button right there. Subscribe to my channel, click onto the bell so that when I release future videos, I can let you know. If you're still bored, I left a video on the screen that I think it's incredible to watch next. And as usual, Otto will always do the honors, and I'm gonna see you very, very soon.